know much about history, don't know much biology, don't know much about history books, and don't know much about the French I took. I like that song. My sermon is actually going to be from 1 Corinthians. And actually, that fits right into it. What I'm going to preach on. Was that Sam Cooke that sang that? Sam Cooke started out with a gospel group. And I'm going to preach on him this morning, too. He's going to fit right into this. You might fit into it, too. Warning. But I got a little note that a friend of mine from Greece called from Athens. He lives, well, a little bit far from Athens. He lives in Naupactos and in Rayon. And when I was there the last time, my daughter went with me, and we went down to Corinth. And that's why I'm preaching out of Corinthians, and I'm telling this story about Corinth. And it's a lot different today than it was when Paul was there. Corinth, not today, it's kind of like a truck stop, a bus stop, because they've cut a slice a little bit wider than my church is, about 50 feet wide, for boats and ships to go through. At one time, they didn't have that in Paul's day. Instead, you had to, if you were going from east to west or west to east, you would go there on one side of the isthmus, you'd unload all your cargo and put it on carts and then go across to the other side and load it up again on other boats that were going the other direction, so you could keep your journey. But there was no way to get around the part of Greece called the Peloponnese, the southern island, huge island. But now they've cut that there, so you don't even have to bother with stopping at Corinth anymore. City's still there. It's in most of it's in ruins, and the new part of it, it's like kind of like the backwoods area. But at the time of Paul, it was a center of great education. They had schools there. People that didn't agree with the doctrines of Aristotle and Plato and Demosthenes and all of these people in Athens, they would leave and start schools in Corinth. And so you had great, what they call schools of thought. We have that today. If you never thought about it, we do. We have schools and they only teach one subject. You go there, and they might throw other stuff in, so you get a rounded education. But you know where to go if you want to be a politician. Go to Harvard or Yale. If you want to be a doctor, go to Ann Arbor. The center of medicine in this country is right here in this state. Believe it or not, people come from all over the world to go to hospitals around Ann Arbor because of the great school of medicine that's there. It's even greater than Rochester, Minnesota, or Mayo Clinic. There's more people actually look to here. More doctors come out of here in Michigan. I bet you didn't know that. But there is. You can go for schools of thought. Now, when Paul got there and he went there to preach, had the vision, come over and help us, he saw a man of Greece in a vision saying, come over and help us. And so he went there to preach the gospel. When he got there, he was astounded, and I've told you this before about him preaching on Mars Hill in Athens when they had the statue of the unknown God. And Paul said, you're really superstitious here. You've got 300 gods up on this mountain, plus you got one you figured out, well, I don't know his name, so we're going to worship him. He's a God that you may not know about. Agnostotheo, the God that you don't know about, where you have a statue to him and an altar to him also. You're very superstitious people. We've got very superstitious people in this world today. Oh, I know people don't want to admit it, that we're that ignorant and heathen, but people live by their superstitions. In America today, it's unbelievable, isn't it? Even well-educated people. I watch them when they go to a sporting event. They have a hat that they wear, and when they wear that hat, that's the lucky hat. We have people that are just in culture, have gone so far in culture that they cannot wiggle themselves out of that culture. Corinth was like that. They had a culture of we're smarter than absolutely everybody else in this whole world. That was their culture. They were smart people. We have college people. They graduate from a college. They don't know how to change the oil in their car or change a spark plug, but they'll tell you right now that they're smarter than anybody else in the rest of the country because they went to a certain school. You know, you can come to this church and not go to heaven. You can go to college and wind up ignorant. You can go in stupid and come out of stupid. Just because you put in the time there, it doesn't change anything. Everybody understand what I'm saying here? And so you had these people here that were super. I don't know if they were super smart or they just intelligent or they just thought they were. Because they didn't have to work with their hands. They sat there in schools of thought and they worked their minds. They wrote down what they thought of. It didn't do any good. The Persians came in later and burned it all. Amen. All of their knowledge, all of their wisdom, everything that they had learned, everything they told each other, a good match destroyed it all. The Persians did it. Now, here, the Iranians, Persians, that's who they were. Well, the truth is, child of God, no matter how smart people think they are, if you don't have Jesus, you don't have anything. That's the point I'm going to make to you here today. You say, oh, well, we're so smart. Well, really, are you now? If you're so smart, how come you don't have Jesus in your heart? Hello? If this world is so doggone smart, how come they don't know the Lord? Amen. You say, well, Brother Ross, I'm not educated in the things they are. Listen, I don't know nothing about brain surgery. But then I don't have to. I know Jesus. See, maybe you're not even thinking like I am. I don't know nothing about doctrine. I'm not a doctor. I'm not a medical doctor. I got Jesus, so what do I need a doctor for? This is just me talking now. I'm not telling anybody else to do anything. But here, this is how he starts this out. In 1 Corinthians, in the second chapter, he said, and I, brethren, now he's talking to the church members in a church that he started in Corinth, okay? He said, and I, brethren, when I came to you, I came not with the excellency of speech or wisdom to declare unto you the testimony of God. For I made up my mind, I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Now there you go. That's the bottom line of the ministry today. That's why people don't want to hear the gospel, because they want to hear the toots and the whistles, and they want to see the smoke and the mirrors, and they want to have the glamour. They want to show. If they're going to go to church, they want to show for their money. We didn't come here to give you a show. And our message is very simple here. It's a simple message of the gospel that does not go with the fads of today. Somebody said, well, he has a ministry where people fall out. I said, I have a ministry where I get people back up. I'd rather get you up than knock you down. Y'all ain't, you don't see humor when I do it, huh? That was funny. But it was true. The truth is, child of God, you and I have to ignore what the fad religion is. We have fads in religion today. things that the Bible doesn't even talk about and doesn't even say, and doesn't you have to have an interpreter to tell you some of these modern doctrines that they have. I can list a number of them. The doctrine of the Antichrist. I don't believe the Antichrist can kill me during a 7-year period, just like I don't believe the Antichrist can kill me now. If the Antichrist can kill me, here I am. What's holding you up? You ain't doing me no favors. The Antichrist, if he can starve you to death with drought and plague and all of this stuff, how come he can't do it to you now? It's the devil. You didn't make a friend of the devil, did you? I mean, you're not friends with the devil, and he's letting you go and get by because one of these days I'm really going to be bad. Well, that's the doctrine of today. They believe more in the Antichrist than they believe in the Christ. I don't believe the devil can kill me. You want to know why? Jesus went into hell and took away the keys of death and the grave away from the devil. It only took him 3 days in that battle. He came back on the third day. So who are you going to believe? You going to believe all these doctrines? I can't believe it. I went down through the channels on the... I'm getting to a sermon here in just a minute. I went down through all these channels, and every one of them had something that is absolutely... If you got a brain in your head, you know it's not true. The ghosts. They got people out here spending millions of dollars trying to find Bigfoot. The United States government spent over $1.5 billion looking for extraterrestrials. My God, they should have given me half that money, and I'd have told them what they found out after 40 years. Ain't nobody there. But you see, we've got fad gospels, and we've got fad churches, and we've got people that thrive on fads. Not too long ago, we had a laughing revival. Everybody, if you're not laughing, well, you ain't in the spirit. People came to my church and they'd sit there and laugh. And I said, what's so funny? I mean, I missed it here. Why are you laughing? Oh, I'm laughing in the spirit. I said, you laughing, but it hadn't got anything to do with the Holy Ghost. Where are they now? They ain't out here laughing now. What happened? Where are they? That was a fad. It came up for a while and now it's gone. There's a lot of people that get saved when movie stars get their favorite movie star comes out and says he's a Christian. You know, like Denzel and me, we're close friends. We're brothers, me and Denzel, you know. You didn't know that? Well, he said he's a Christian, born again, saved. That makes him my brother, doesn't it? Bet you didn't know me and Denzel was close. Hallelujah. The truth is, some people only follow whatever is popular at the moment. And when that popularity is gone, this seductive voice from the world that has weaseled itself into the church, and you know it has. Don't get mad at me. I've watched some programs on TV where they got an effeminate choir director, and it's a man. And they think, well, oh, there's nothing wrong with that. You know, don't you see, they got laws about that now. You can't even talk about it. You can lose your 501c3 nonprofit designation if you preach against gay marriage. They wrote us a letter. Didn't stop I don't work for the government. Let them police their own business. Leave me alone. Amen. And that's what the Constitution tells them they have to do. You and I need to know that whatever is seductive in this world has no place in the house of God. That's why when I come to this scripture here in verse 2 of 1 Corinthians, the second chapter, 1 Corinthians 2:2, I determined not to know anything among you save Jesus Christ and him crucified. All these other things are distractions. Put them out of your mind. Stop worrying about all the things that the world is worried about. Amen. Stop worrying about what the devil wants to interject into your mind and get you to get your mind on instead of keeping your mind on the Lord. If you keep on your everybody that stayed, you got your mind stayed on him, you're in perfect peace right now. If you're in turmoil, you haven't kept your mind stayed on the Lord. Keep your mind on Jesus, huh? They're trying to tow us away from the sine qua non. They're trying to get us from this place where we walk with God and talk with God, and we're in the Spirit, and we have the Holy Ghost abiding in us, and we obey his leading and do what he tells us to do. And unless we're doing that, child of God, that's why Paul said, I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. I am not going to debate with some moron that doesn't believe in God and believes in evolution. Why am I going to argue with him? He doesn't believe in God. And the fool, he's a fool. Is anybody listening to me? The Bible said he's a fool who has said in his heart, there is no God. My grandpa told me, you stand and argue with a fool, you're a fool too. Why am I going to argue with that? And then they came out with this. Listen to this. When they can't defend their argument, I'm talking about scientists now. Scientists, when they no longer can defend their argument, then they say, this, listen now, is settled science. This has already been settled. We can't talk about that anymore. This has already been settled by wise people. You know, like Charles Darwin on his deathbed said, bring me my book. And they brought him in a book that he wrote, Origin of Species. And he said, no, not that one. Bring me the Bible. There's only one book when you're dying. Can anybody say amen? I don't know if he was saved or not, but I'm going to tell you, they made a God out of his religion. His religion is there is no God. And the way you got here was by complete accident. In all of these billions of stars, there's only one place in the whole universe with man. And they say, that's a result of random chance. I don't believe it. Instead, I'm not going to argue with somebody. You know what's settled? This old account here, it was settled long ago. That's what's settled. The Bible is settled. It's not going to change. God's not going to change his mind just because we got a new school coming along. God's not going to change his mind. He still is the same God as he was in the beginning, as he is right now. He's a God of power, a God of love, a God of understanding, a God of laws. He's a God of regulation. He's the God who made you. He brought you forth into this world. Man didn't make you. Your parents probably didn't even know you were coming. Now we can do away with God. God ain't in charge of bringing life into the world. We can kill a baby now. The mother's got a right to choose. The time the mother had a right to choose is before she went to bed with somebody. Of course, you see, I'm not politically correct, am I? It's not after you've created a life, or a life is living in you. Whatever things were gained to me. This is Paul talking here. Philippians 3, 7 and 8. Whatsoever things were gained to me, those things I have counted all as loss for the sake of Christ. More than that, I count all things to be lost in view of the surprising value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I've suffered the loss of all things, but I count them rubbish, so that I may gain Christ. Boy, I bet you can't sell that sermon on Wall Street. Walk down through there with these people so greedy that they'll steal the gold out of your mouth. And you say to them, this don't mean nothing. And they'll say to you, well, you're crazy. Call the men in the white uniforms and take him up to Bellevue. This man's lost his mind. You stand out there and say, your money's going to perish with you. And they say, oh, well, don't worry, I'm investing in gold and in minerals. Gold will melt, and it'll run away. There's nothing important in this life. I need you to look at me right now, because if I ever told you anything that is important here, you need to know Jesus Christ and him crucified and forget everything else, because this is the only thing that you're going to be able to stand on when the world ends. People are talking about the end of the world. Well, where are you going to be when the world ends? I'm going to be standing on the rock. He said he would not leave me and would not forsake me. He would be with me to the end of this world, until there's nothing else. Jesus Christ is going to be by my side, but closer than that, I believe Jesus lives on the inside of his people. Can you say amen? Well, Brother Ross, it says here in the book of Revelation, listen, I'm going to tell you something. You need to read the first line of the book of Revelation. It is not a revelation about Israel. It is not a revelation about the Antichrist. It is not a revelation about a certain particular church. It's the revelation of Jesus Christ. The word apocalypse means uncovering. It doesn't mean the end of the world. It means to pull back the curtain and let you see for real. And you know, it starts out there in the very first chapter of the book of Revelation, where it is a revelation of Jesus Christ. He's praying. He said, I was in the Spirit on the Lord's day, and all of a sudden behind me, I had heard a voice that sounded like many waters, a big roaring voice. And I turned around, and when I looked, I saw a man, hallelujah, standing in the midst of seven golden candlesticks, and his hair was like lamb's wool, hallelujah, and his eyes were like coals of fire, and out of his mouth came a sharp two-edged sword, and around his waist was a girdle of gold. And as he stood there, all of a sudden, he said, I didn't know who he was. Who art thou? And then he spoke to me. When he spoke to you, did you hear his voice? His name is Jesus. And he said, here, I'm going to tell you who I am. I am Alpha and I am Omega. I am the beginning. I am the end. I am the first and the last. And beside me, there is no other. I am him who liveth and was dead. But behold, I am alive forevermore. There's our revelation. Somebody asked me, do you study the book of Revelation? I said, oh, every bit of it, every word. I've looked them all up, every one of them, to see if I missed any idiom or any idea or any inference or anything else. But it comes back to the very first line. This is a revelation of Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ came to you to let you know who he is, not who Israel is. He came to let you know who he is, not the Antichrist. Hallelujah. He came to reveal himself to you, so you would know him, where he came from and what he has done for you and what he means in our lives. When you get back to that, church, then you'd say, hey, from now on, I don't know nothing except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Paul wanted nothing. He wasn't worried about anything. And if you look here in verse 4, he said, the only thing I did here, my speech and my preaching was not with enticing words of man's wisdom. Listen to this. Paul, the greatest one of the apostles, don't get me wrong. One-third of the Bible, he wrote it. It's all right there. Paul, this apostle said, listen, I didn't come to you to entice you with clever words. And you know, we've got people who are wordsmiths now. I'm going to tell you, they can get up and they can talk some talk. I don't care. So, oh, but he's a positive thinker. He's a positive attitude person. What did it get you? Paul said, I didn't come to you in enticing words of man's wisdom, but here's what he came to. I have come in demonstration of the Spirit of God and of power. You want to build a church? You want to change a life? Stop talking and start getting the demonstration of God's Holy Spirit. Amen. Let's get the power of God moving in our lives. Let's show a demonstration of the Spirit. Don't sit around talking to me, Mark 11:23, and right next door, Mark 11:24, thou shalt say unto this mountain, be thou removed, and it should obey you. If you do not move a mountain, what's the point in talking about faith if you don't heal somebody, if you don't cast out a devil, if you don't raise the dead, if you don't do the works that Jesus sent us to do? What is a clever sermon all about? I'm going to tell you right now, we're on the threshold of a great move of God. A great move of God. A move of God that is going to be in demonstration and power of the Spirit of God. And he said, when I came to you, this is over in chapter 4, when I came to you, I determined not to know the speech of them that are puffed up. Oh, my Lord. How many puffed up folks we got nowadays? They got saved 3 weeks ago, and now they can tell you what the Bible means. Amen. They went to a crusade, and now they know everything. The truth is, child of God, the only way that you're going to get the demonstration and the power of the Spirit is you got to know God. You got to know Him. You got to walk in Him. You got to talk in Him. You got to move in Him. As he said, Epimenides, one of your own philosophers said, in Him we move and breathe and have our being. How many people do you know like that right now? We've got hordes of people who can tell you the statistics of baseball players playing in Chicago and Cleveland. They can tell you their whole history. Well, you know what he did back in 1918 and what they did. And then this guy here, you know who he was? Who cares? We've got much ado about nothing here. They're paying millions of dollars for absolutely nothing. Why do you labor for that which is not bread? And yet we do. Well, people got to be entertained, you know. You put in your 40 hours, you got to clock out, you got to, grab a little TV, grab a little something to eat, get a little beer, put your feet up, change the channels, you know, find a good movie, find a good ball game somewhere. Is that life? It is to many people. You talk to them on Monday morning, and the only thing they can talk to you about is about how drunk they got. Hello? Or what new drug they tried. I'm not in that crowd. I'm not of them. I'm in this world, but I'm not of this world. I'm walking around in the same world, breathing the same air that they are, but my mind is not where their mind is. My mind's on another thing. My mind's on God. My mind's on His goal. My mind is on what God wants me to do and what God wants me to be. And listen, many times, child of God, we have gotten to this place before. We have had great catastrophes in this world so much that it changed the entire history of the church. Hardly anybody talks about the bubonic plague that killed only left one third of the people alive in Europe. And they make no connection between that and Martin Luther. No connection between so many millions of people dying and death in the streets and burning bodies. And that's all they did. The clang goes out 3 times a day, bring out your dead, because they had to collect the dead bodies to keep everything from putrefying in houses. Nobody makes a connection between that and Martin Luther and the Reformation, who came along where people began to read the Word of God, and all of a sudden their lives were changed. They threw off the old system and they got a hold of a new system of freedom. Is anybody listening to this? It was a great catastrophe that caused that. And somebody said, oh, Brother Ross, there's so many of them, they're going to overrun the whole world. I heard somebody just say that. And I said, oh, not so fast. But when Ben-Hadad came out of Syria and he attacked Samaria, you know what God did? God killed the whole army overnight, 190,000 men. One night, they're gone. Now go down and get all their gold. That's what God told them to do. One night. And you know what? They said it was the hantavirus. That's what man came up with. How did they die? They knew they died. Nobody knew how they died. Recently, they came up and said, it's the hantavirus. That's what killed them. Mice with little bugs on them breathed in the same air and ate their food. And that's how the hantavirus killed them overnight. It wasn't no hantavirus. It was an angel of God. Can I tell you, you want to know who's going to fight my battles for me? The angel of the Lord. You want to know who's going to keep the Antichrist out of my house? The angel of the Lord. You want to know who's going to bring food and put it on my table when there ain't no food in the grocery stores? The angel of the Lord. Hallelujah. He's going to deliver food to me every day. Hallelujah. You say, oh, Brother Ross, you've gone crazy. Yes, I have. I've gone back to what Jesus said. And I've determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and what he has to say. When we start boiling this down to what Jesus says, I'm going to tell you, you have to listen here. The church in America has become the slave of American culture. We have become religious consumers who shop around for the best financial deal that delivers the best returns on the money we invest. That's how people pick churches nowadays. Well, what am I going to get out of this? After all, if I'm going to go over there and I'm going to, what's going to happen to me? Has nothing to do with worshiping God. You know, I've walked out of denominations that all they had on their mind was nickels and noses. You know what I'm talking about? When you fill out the paper, how many people were there? How much was the offering? That's the only thing they ask. They don't ask, did anybody get saved? That's why I left those denominations. The truth is, child of God, you and I have to get back to the old landmark. We have to stay in the service of the Lord. We have to get back to what's really real. And this is why Paul said, when I got there, I made up my mind. I determined to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. Listen, all of us right now, you're either going to fall on one side of this fence or the other side. You have no choice about it. If you don't decide, it's going to be decided for you. Are you going to fall into the culture of this world and these fad and quick gospels? Hallelujah. Nowadays, to get saved, most people in evangelistic meetings, if there are any anymore, I haven't really seen an evangelistic meeting in a long time. But if there are any, what do they do? When you come down to the altar, you say a little prayer and go about your business. And they say, oh, you're saved now, because it's all a mental thing. Well, I didn't get saved that way. They dragged me down to the altar, and I prayed and prayed and prayed. And are you saved yet? Well, I don't feel any yet. Well, pray some more. If God doesn't change your life, what is there about a new birth? If you get up and go back and do the same stuff you've been doing before, how did you get saved? What do you call salvation here? I'm getting back to the old landmark. And listen, Paul said to Timothy in 2 Timothy 4:10, he said, remember Demas, many have come like him. He having loved this present world, he has deserted the Lord and gone back. And they got excuses and reasons. Everybody's got a reason for something. They got, well, you know why I did that, and you know why that happened, and you know who did this, and if they hadn't done this, then this wouldn't have happened. Listen, grow up. Stop blaming other people for the mess you're in. Get your mind on God. Hallelujah. Only he can bring you out. I preached last Sunday, if you'll remember, I preached only God can put the yellow back into an egg after it's been broken. Then you say, well, it's impossible. Well, you don't know God. I've had people say, well, Brother Ross, you don't know my husband. Well, he don't know God. You don't know God. If you think God cannot fix every situation that there is, God knows what he's doing. He's been in the people business a long time. God can change your life, turn you into another man. Hallelujah. He'll make the alcoholic and wino push his cup away. He'll make you throw the drug addict throw his crack pipe away. He can pick a man up out of the gutter who has vomit and dirty clothes and been laying there for 3 days on his drunk. He can pick him up, save him, clean him up, shave him up, put him on new clothes, and send him out to preach the gospel because he knows what he's talking about. My God, these I can almost get upset about this. You look at some of these preachers, they're like third and fourth generation preachers. They don't know what sin is. My God, I'd like to find somebody that actually been saved, not didn't get religion by osmosis. Well, I was in the number, and so therefore, I guess I'm saved too. Well, your daddy was a preacher, and your grandpa was a preacher. You ought to be a preacher too. Well, I guess so, because it's easier than studying to be a doctor. No, it's not. Actually, it costs you your life. You want to be a minister of the gospel? I have people wanting to be ordained all the time. And I tell them, well, how much is this going to cost? I said, you mean for that piece of paper you want me to send you? That's pennies. Hallelujah. You want to know what the ministry is going to cost you? It's going to cost you absolutely everything. And if you're not willing to give up everything to serve the Lord and follow the Lord, you're not worthy to put your hand on this plow. You need to say amen on a couple of these things, or else I'm going to think I'm preaching right at you. This thing's about Jesus anyway. Hallelujah. It's a revelation of Jesus. You've got to, no matter where your study takes you, if it doesn't center around Jesus, no matter what your, how many times have I read the Old Testament and come up with the same conclusion? That I'm lost if I don't get saved and have Jesus. Oh, I've studied it all. I've studied a dozen religions, ones that are in the news. I've studied at Al-Aqsa Mosque in Jerusalem and could. Huh? I've gone to India and walked around among Buddhists. Some of them claim to be descended. You know something? I went there to Medina where Muhammad is buried. And I said, Muhammad's buried under all that marble? Yeah. Are you sure Muhammad's there? Yeah. I said, well, isn't that odd? The Lord that I serve, he's up there. Muhammad died. Well, they killed Jesus too, but Jesus came back. Can anybody say amen here? Even Gandhi, Mohandas Gandhi, said the main thing that separates Jesus Christ from every other proposed leader in religion in this world is that when they killed him, he came back to life again. Come on, say amen. This same joy lives in my heart today. This world, I'm not afraid of the gun that shoots, the knife that cuts, the bomb that blows up. I'm not afraid of those things. And I'm not afraid of the lion in the lion's den, or the fire in the furnace, or the whale that wants to swallow me and hold me down. You want to know why? I got Jesus on the inside, and that's enough. The devil cannot destroy what God has blessed. God has blessed me. God has blessed you. God has brought you safe this far. Where could you have been right now if it had not been for the Lord who kept his hand of blessing on your life? 1 Corinthians 1:24. I don't know. I don't know if I should get into all the first chapter of Corinthians, because it leads up to this. You know, and it's really spectacular. Somebody told me, said, Brother, I'll start baptizing people and you'll add members to the church. The Apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:17, Christ sent me not to baptize, but to preach the gospel. Now, what about that? You want to be like Paul? Well, you're not going to be a Baptist then. I guess John was the baptizer. In other words, child of God, what Paul said is, look, I'm laying all of this religion stuff aside. There was nobody better educated in religion than Paul. Nobody. He studied in Jerusalem as part of the Sanhedrin under a mentor named Gamaliel. He was a brilliant man when it came to the law. And he also studied the law of Rome. That's why, I'm going to tell you, he wasn't dumb when he stood before these Roman procurators. He stood there and he spoke to them. And he told them, well, look, I know what you're getting ready to decide. Don't decide it. I appeal to Caesar. And Festus said, well, I was going to turn him loose. I mean, there wasn't anything I could hold him for, but he appealed to Caesar. And because he appealed to Caesar, I have to send him to Rome. He got free passage to Rome. Hallelujah. So he wasn't a dumb man. He was very smart. But listen carefully now. I have a list of the ones that God is going to choose. Listen now. This is important to us, because this is a group of people that Paul says in verse 24, them which are called. Are you ready now? Them which are called. In other words, they can be Jews or Greeks, they can be from anywhere, but if God calls them, they're going to stand in the wisdom of God. Drop down with me here in verse 27. God hath chosen the foolish things of this world. My Lord, now that just rubs me backwards on all of my sophisticated education in church. Why would God choose the foolish things? You know why? To confound the wise. They can't figure it out. The wise people cannot figure out why Christianity. They say, oh, well, are you giving away food? No. Are you giving away clothes? No. Are you giving away money? No. Are you giving away free jobs? No. He said, well, why did they come to church? They can't figure it out. You give them free medical? No. Well, why did they come to church then? See, they can't figure this out, can they? Wise people can't figure. Well, why church? You don't need a church. You got the government. The government gives you food, gives you housing, gives you a free education, gives you free health care. The government will do all that for you. Why do you need God for? Well, it ain't about that. Huh? God just acts. Sometimes he takes the most foolish person among us. Why? To confound the wise. Let's go on. What else has God chosen? God has chosen the weak things to confound the things which are mighty. What about that, church? We look around us and we have ways that we judge something. Now listen, don't get me foolish here. In Philadelphia, I had the Frasers. Marvis Fraser came to my church. Joe Fraser came often. I realize right now I'm not as strong as those guys. You know, I thought I was kind of tough at one time, and you know, I had a boxing auditorium there that we had boxing events, and Joe said, "Oh yeah, you want to keep fit?" He said, "Come up to my gym," and I said, "Okay." So I'm up there. I'm jumping the rope. I'm dancing around, you know. I float like a butterfly. I was floating more like a bowl of jelly. Amen. Wasn't no sting in my bee. Hallelujah. And so Joe said, "Well, yeah, come on up here for a minute. Let's see what you got." And I get up there, and you know, Joe Fraser. Hello, Joe. You know Joe Fraser, smoking Joe Fraser. Joe Fraser, world heavyweight champion, broke Ali's jaw, knocked him down. That Joe Fraser. And I said, I'm all padded up and everything, you know, and I got a helmet on. And I said, "Oh, come on, Joe, just give me one little punch here. Huh? No, don't hold back any." He gave me a left hook. I didn't think I was ever going to walk again. I'm not talking about that kind of strength. Some of you need strength in your life right now. You need strength to stand. You need the strength of a determined heart and a made-up mind. You need strength to say, "I'm going to live for the Lord, and I'm not going to mess with this world." And if you don't do that, I'm actually going to tell you the truth here. If nobody else will, I'm going to tell you the truth. If you do not live for God and make up your mind to come apart from this world and taste not, touch not, handle not the unclean thing, I promise you right now, you will stand here and watch me fly away. Because you ain't going. "Well, I'm a member of the church." Church membership don't have it. Hallelujah. Jack Coe said, church membership is no different than going out and writing your name on the barn door and shaking the donkey's tail. Write your name on the church book and shake the preacher's hand. Don't matter. It ain't going to matter. That doesn't matter to God. When Jesus comes back, there's one thing that the Lord is going to be looking for. Only one thing. When the Lord comes back, will he find faith on this earth? Faith. You and I have faith in our heart, yes, but we are weakening to the things of this world. Here, do this. Oh, well, it don't matter. That's like, you know, I may come over here and cast a demon out of Sister Murphy here someday soon, because she keeps bringing me all of these desserts back there. Oh, one bite won't hurt you. See, that's my problem. That's why I hate Halloween. You know, I ain't got no Halloween stuff down here. You want to know why? I hate Halloween. You want to know why? All them kids get to eat all the chocolate, and I can't have any. Oh, you can have just one. No, I can't. I can't eat one little bite of chocolate. I go crazy on it. It's like an addiction. I mean, heroin, cocaine, it don't mean matter nothing, but chocolate. It's got my number. Listen to this. You've got to be strong. How do you do that when you're actually told to be weak? It's because your strength cannot be in your own understanding. Your strength has to be in the Spirit. To confound the mighty and base things of this world. You know what base things are? This word here literally means like you're walking down the street and you got something on the bottom of your shoe and you're trying to get it off. That's how what base things are. Beneath, literally dirtiness beneath you. And you know something? I said it a minute ago, that God can take an alcoholic who's been drinking for a week and he stinks and he's got a beard growth on him and vomit all over his clothes and raise him up and save him, fill him with the Holy Ghost, call him to preach, dress him up and send him out. And does anybody know more what he's talking about when he talks about Jesus saves? It happened right downtown here in Detroit. Used to have a church down there on Gratiot. You look up and you see a neon cross. Church is gone now. Probably gas station there or something, or flea market. I don't know what it's there. But it used to be down there, and it said, Jesus saves. It kept flashing. There's a man here in town. I'm going to end with this. When he would work at Ford, he'd come home with his paycheck and pass his house up and go to the bar on the corner. He would spend his entire paycheck getting drunk. Everything that he earned, he spent it. And then 5 o'clock, 6 o'clock in the morning, he'd come climbing up those stairs and crashed down on the bed and stayed drunk from Friday night to Sunday night and sober up just long enough to go to work on Monday morning. He had a good wife, a praying wife, a Christian wife, went to church wife. She worked, she took in laundry, she took in clothes and she repaired and she did all of this and made enough money for her and her daughter to live in the apartment that she paid for. She couldn't depend upon him for anything. Even though he made good money, he drank it all up when he got paid. Here he is now. Came home 6 o'clock in the morning, and his wife woke him up and said, I can't leave my daughter. I have to stay here and take care of her. She has a fever. The doctor told me that if we would just get this medicine and give it to her, it's written on a piece of paper, and I'm going to give you now $10. Take this $10 and go buy that medicine and bring it back, and I'll give it to our daughter, and it'll probably save her life. Well, you know what he did with the $10? He went to the corner bar. He got drunk and didn't come home. Monday afternoon sometime, you know, this is all written down. You can read this story. Monday afternoon, so I've been in this place downtown Detroit here many times. He came home Monday afternoon, and his wife had the little girl laying on the kitchen table, washed, pale, and she said, "Our daughter has died. We didn't get the medicine in time. She's dead. Here she is." And said, "Look, I have saved just a little bit of money, $5. There's a little used dress store down here. I've already talked to the man. Take this $5. You know what he did? He took the $5 and got drunk. His own daughter. He came back to the apartment when he sobered up, and the apartment was empty. And he went out to tried to work, and they paid him for a week, and then he tried to work another week. He had no place to go home to, nothing. And he turned into a street bum, drinking everything he could. Laying in the gutter, right down here on Woodward Avenue. Hating himself so much, covered in a 3 days growth of beard. Clothes that were not fit to put on, covered with his own vomit. He laid there in the rain, in the gutter. And he looked up and he saw that cross blinking on and off. Jesus saves. And he said a simple prayer. He said, "God, I'm worthless, but don't let me die this way." Well, somebody came by and picked him up and said, "Hey, you need to get up out of the street." They took him into the church. "Where do you want to go?" "Is that church open?" "Yes, they used to be open down there at night because of the drunks and the bums. They'd stay open all night long." And they took him in there and they got him cleaned up. And he'd ask him, how do I give my heart to the Lord? He said, "I pray." And they told his story, and they were so impressed by him, they all started helping him. You know what his name is? Mel Trotter. If you go down here to the original Detroit Rescue Mission, that's his work. He's dedicated the rest of his life. When I used to come here to town with Brother Allen, I used to go down to his place and help him make soup all night long so we could give out soup in the morning. I loved his testimony. I love this man. He was great. And you know something? What does God have to do? When you get down to why would God choose somebody like him? When you got all these goody-two-shoes, ain't never done nothing wrong, ain't never been out of the church in their life. Why would God choose a drunk alcoholic, worthless, let his own daughter die? So he could have something else to drink. But God did. God chose the base things of this world. What is the next one? Does it say things which are not? Invisible things. God creates circumstances. And you know why he does it? Here it is in verse 29. You want to know why God's going to choose you? Hallelujah. If you learn this, if you learn what I'm saying here today, you know why God chose me? I can tell you. Because I do not lean on my own understanding. I do not trust in myself. I trust in the Lord. Because what I cannot do, I do know one thing for sure. Standing here in front of you, I can say, God knows what he's doing, and God has my best interest in mind, and I trust the Lord with all of my heart. And if you'll do that, I guarantee you won't worry about no Antichrist. You won't worry about demons. You won't worry about getting robbed. You won't worry about getting shot and getting your head cut off and getting stabbed and all of these many things that happen to people who do not know Jesus. You say, "Oh, wait a minute, Brother Ross, they're killing Christians over there." Well, that's a different, I got to tell you right now. Those Christians, I believe they believe in Jesus. But let me tell you one difference between them and me. I got the Holy Ghost. And I can tell you right now, greater is he who is in me than he who is in this world. Join hands with somebody right now if you would. I'm doing better. Pick one. Tonight I'm going to go into Philippians because it goes along with this. And I'm going to go into Revelation. It goes along with this. And then I'm going to do some demonstration and power in the Spirit. Everybody loves Jesus, say amen. Oh, Mel Trotter's favorite song. I must tell Jesus all of my trials. I cannot bear these burdens alone, and in my distress He kindly will help me. Jesus will help me. Jesus alone. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear these burdens alone. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me. Alone, I've been tempted and tried, and I need a great Savior, one who will all my burden. And I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me. Jesus. Oh, come on, raise both hands up to the Lord and sing. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. I cannot bear the burden all alone. I must tell Jesus. I must tell Jesus. Jesus can help me. Jesus. Oh, Jesus can help me. Jesus alone. Come on, let's just worship Him this morning.